Well, let's get into the Bible, amen. I want to start off with a story. You know, back in 1914 on Christmas Eve, during World War I, the British soldiers were lying in the trenches. On the other side of no man's land, the Germans kept their heads down in the trenches too. But it was Christmas Eve, so a few British soldiers put on some lights and a couple of trees. At first, the Germans were very suspicious, because it's war, and they were very suspicious, but later realized what the British were doing. One German started singing Silent Night. It was joined in by the other soldiers. The Englishmen applauded afterward. Then the British started to sing songs, and the Germans afterwards clapped themselves. After some awkward silence, I'm pretty sure it kind of got very awkward at a time, it's still in the midst of war. One soldier rose from his side of the battlefield and walked straight into the middle of no man's land, which was the middle of the battlefield. After a while, more soldiers from both sides began to walk into the middle of this battlefield. And while in the middle, they began to exchange goods. On the next day, Christmas Day, the truce continued. Even a soccer match was played between the two opposing countries. It's really cool how sports can really unite countries here, as we're in the midst of the World Cup right now, right? So even though everyone may have their own team they're rooting for, guess what? You could come to some unity, do some soccer. As the story continues on, it says, soldiers who were killed before were given a proper burial during the truce. And it said that someone even read from the 23rd Psalm. A few from the two sides swapped names and addresses for contact after the war if they were to make it out alive. One side held up a sign saying, Merry Christmas, while the other side responded, thank you. However, the next morning on December 26th, the killing commenced. The war picked back up and lasted another 4 years. And about 9 million people were killed in all. In the area where the battlefield was located, they placed this wooden cross. This is historical evidence here. They placed this wooden cross here to symbolize as a memorial for those who served in that war. And served in that war, and it represents a memorial of an unofficial ceasefire between the British and the Germans during World War I. You know, as we all know, Christmas is right around the corner. And the Christmas spirit is great and powerful. You have your Hallmark movies. Everyone's in a Christmas spirit, singing Christmas songs and having all the decorations. But it typically ends on December 26th. After all of that, life busyness start to happen again. Work, the rat race of life, school for some, and you begin to retake control of your lives again. And it's interesting because so many different events all throughout history kind of paints that same picture, does it not? I mean, what happened in 9/11 was tragic. And at that time, the world seemed to care for just a split second. They began to have compassion on those around them. However, long after that, people went back into their day-to-day lives. Even in the midst of 2020, in the beginning of the pandemic and COVID-19, the world froze for a second, and people began to have compassion for each other and care for each other's needs. And as time went on, as the world began to open back up, and our workplaces began to open back, and our schools began to open back up, the world just turned back to their ordinary lives. I mean, crime went back up, addiction went back up, so much hatred went back up. And it makes me think, perhaps, it's because we don't just need the spirit of Christmas. We need the spirit of Christ. We just don't need a season, but we need a savior. We don't just need a bunch of people who come into church during this time of the year waiting on a Christmas miracle in their lives. But yet, we have to understand that God has called us from this dark world, that through Christ, we get to be the miracle, which brings me to the title of my lesson today, Be the Miracle. Be the miracle, Southland. You know, God's been doing so much incredible things this year. And if I was to leave with one more final thought, just to encourage my brothers and sisters in this room, is just that, to be the miracle. You know, author and speaker Stuart Briscoe once said, the spirit of Christmas needs to be superseded by the spirit of Christ. The spirit of Christmas is annual. The spirit of Christ is eternal. The spirit of Christmas is sentimental. The spirit of Christ is supernatural. The spirit of Christmas is a human product. The spirit of Christ is a divine person. And let that be said of Southland, that we are those who tap into that spirit that was given to us at baptism. And we got the indwelling of that spirit. The same spirit that gives you power is the same spirit that give Christ the power to resurrect from the grave, as it says in Ephesians 1. It's the same spirit that dwells inside of us that not make us timid, but gives us the power of love and self-discipline, as it says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. That's the miracle. I mean, think about it. Without God, none of us in our right mind can ever have control over our sin. Without God, none of us can actually have a spirit of discipline and overcome the temptations in our lives that's always there, day in and day out. That's a miracle. The fact that you are no longer the same person that you were 5 years ago. That you're no longer the same person that you was yesterday and the day before that. That because of God's spirit that dwells inside of you, for those who are in Christ, you get to have an overcoming spirit that makes you the miracle. And the Bible, all throughout the scriptures, calls us to keep in step with this spirit. And as we keep in step with the spirit, guess what? It's constantly helping you be more and more the miracle. You know, let's look at in our Bibles at a guy who decided to be just that, the miracle. And as this guy decided to make that his conviction, he had a ripple effect on those around him that they too were called by God to be the miracle in their day and age. Are you with me? Let's go to Nehemiah chapter 1. I hope we're still fired up here. I hope it's just not the Christmas spirit in this room, amen? But I hope it's the spirit filled up in our bones that's from God, amen? Nehemiah chapter 1. Be the spirit. And my first point is, know that you are a miracle. Nehemiah chapter 1, begin up here, verse 1, and it says in the Bible, it says, the words of Nehemiah, son of Hechaliah, in the month of Kislev, in the 20th year, while I was in the citadel of Susa, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men. And I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that had survived the exile, and also about Jerusalem. They said to me, those who survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burnt with fire. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I even mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven, and the church said, amen. Know that you are the miracle. Here, Nehemiah catches wind of the state of his people, his countrymen, the place where he would have risen and born, and he takes note that these guys are in trouble. And at this time, scholars believe in 586 BC, during the third exile of God's people because of their sin, it was also during the time period when the Babylonians ransacked Jerusalem. And they just didn't just take the people as hostage and just let the buildings be what it was. No, they destroyed almost everything in sight. They destroyed the temple, the place of worship at the time for God's people, where God would dwell. Just imagine that for a second. That we are here right now worshiping God, and all of a sudden is destroyed and blown down to rubble. And not just that, the walls, it's the fence of the city that will protect all the people, their children, the wives, the husbands, their elders. The walls were broken down. The city was exposed. And he gets news of this during his time of Kislev. Kislev was this Jewish month, and it was right around the time of now, during the winter. The Jewish people at this time would celebrate, you know, different festivals, and one in particular was Hanukkah. And so it would be this time of in general sense, a time of celebration and joy and remembrance, but yet, sadly, because of the conditions, it was a time of sorrow. And I think maybe some can relate during this time of the year. For some, it's a sense of joy, but maybe for some, it could be a place of sorrow. And how does Nehemiah respond to such a dire situation that he's now in his life that he didn't plan for? In verse 4, we see that he turns to God in prayer. That he falls on his knees to God, like, God, help me in my current situation. And you may wonder, like, what happened next? Well, let's look over to chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. You guys still with me?
Yeah.
Amen. What happened next? In chapter 2, verse 1, we pick it up here. It says, in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when wine was brought for him, I took the wine and gave it to the king. I had not been sad in his presence before. So the king asked me, why does your face look so sad when you are not ill? This can be nothing but sadness of heart. I was very much afraid, but I said, the king, may the king live forever. Why should my face not look sad when a city where my ancestors are buried lies in ruins? And his gates have been destroyed by fire. The king said to me, what is it you want? Then I prayed to the God of heaven, and I answered the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in his sight, let him send me to the city in Judah where my ancestors are buried so that I can rebuild it. Then the king with the queen, which was Esther at that time, sit beside him, asked him, how long will your journey take, and when will you get back? It pleased the king to send me, so I set a time. I also said to him, if it pleases the king, may I have letters to the governors, Trans-Euphrates, so that they will provide me self-conduct until I arrive in Judah. And may I have a letter to Asaph, keeper of the royal park, so he would give me my timber to make beams for the gates of the citadel, by the temple and for the city wall, and for the residents I will occupy. And because the gracious hand of my God was on me, the king granted my request. So I went to the governor of Trans-Euphrates and gave them the king's letters. The king has also sent army officers and cavalry with me. When Sanballat, the Horonite, and Tobiah, the Ammonite, official heard about this, they were very much disturbed that someone had the audacity, that someone had come to promote the welfare of the Israelites. Verse 11, I went to Jerusalem. And after staying there 3 days, I set out during the night with a few others. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on. By night, I went out through the valley gate toward the jackal well and the dung gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on toward the fountain gate in the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through. So I went up the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or the priests or nobles or officials of any others who would be doing the work. Then I said to them, you see the trouble we are in? Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burnt with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace. Also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me and what the king has said to me. And the people replied, let us start rebuilding. Wow. Know that you are the miracle. We see time passes here. At one point, it was the time of the winter. Now it's the time of the spring during the month of Nisan. And it was during the month of the Passover. It was the month of first fruits of barley. And God is doing incredible things. And we see Nehemiah's heart was broken for his people. He see the condition of his community and his family. And he wanted to do something about it. He was full of compassion for his people. So he prays and prays that God moves the heart of the king to grant his request to go back to the country and rebuild it. And I love here in verse 5, it says, it was merely the king not just sending Nehemiah physically. No. Nehemiah understand that he was called by God. Nehemiah walked with God. He had a godly character. He was faithful to God. So it wasn't just the king sending Nehemiah physically. No, Nehemiah had a conviction that was God sending him spiritually to do something about it. Nehemiah was sent to be the miracle. Nehemiah knew that he was the miracle. And I love this because in verse 12, we see it. It says, I set out during the night with a few others. I had not told anyone what my God has set upon my heart. We all have something that maybe God's put upon your heart even this morning. And it's interesting, like you may share something like, or maybe you might hold on to it even. And it's interesting because it's funny that no one else feels that same way but you. And maybe it's because God put that on your heart for a reason. So that, like Nehemiah, you're not the problem, but you can be the solution. What was on his heart? I would like to believe his people was on his heart because they were in trouble. He wanted to do something about it. I believe his family was on his heart. His God was on his heart. The hopeless and oppressed souls of the community was on his heart. And he wanted to do something about it. He wanted to be the miracle. And he also knew he was the miracle. You know, I think about this movie that we all are familiar with. It's called The Matrix. And The Matrix is this character, Neo, who was caught, right? And Morpheus would be like his teacher, if you will, like this godly character in the movie. And once Neo is caught, and Morpheus is really just trying to teach him so many different things about the real world. And he's trying to help Neo really tap in and to have self-discovery and realize truly who he is. And I love this scene in the movie where Neo's in this machine and he's plugged in and is downloading all this information into him, basically. And he wakes up out of this dream and he says, I know karate. You know? And Morpheus is like, show me. And they go into this virtual space and they're like training, they're doing karate in this karate dojo. And Morpheus is giving him the business, dude. Like, he's like laying it on him, right? And I love that during this time, Neo is also still training. And though he's chosen and he's called, he still haven't fully discovered and fully realized that just yet. And Morpheus is still teaching him the principles as this life is happening, and all of a sudden, as he's fighting back, and then Neo just switched gears. He taps into a place that was already inside of him. You follow me? And he switches gears, and now he's like going off on Morpheus to the point where he defeats Morpheus in that scene. But I love this scene because Morpheus says something very profound. He tells Neo, I only can show you the door, it's on you to walk through it. And I believe the same way when it comes to our lives today. God can only show you through the scriptures. It's up to you to believe it and actually walk through it. That God has already shown you through the scriptures that he's called you. He's chosen you, that he loves you. He set you apart for such a task as this. But do you believe that? Do you know that? Nehemiah knew that. Nehemiah, it was who he was. That's why I love all throughout the scriptures. He says it. The gracious hand of my God is on me. He knew that God was sending him. He knew God was opening up doors of opportunity. It was so clear in Nehemiah's life. Is it clear to you this morning? You see, when it's clear to someone, it gives them the confidence, it gives them the competence, because it's all from God. They know they're walking close to God, and their identity is rooted in God. And for us, we have to understand, as disciples, we are a miracle. God's already set you apart. You're already the miracle. You're saved. You're a miracle. I really believe that's why in Matthew 9, Jesus is trying to convince and really open up his minds of his disciples. In Matthew 9, it's during a time when Jesus and his disciples are walking, and Jesus sees the multitude of people and the crowds of people, and he's just full of compassion. And he tells his disciples, hey, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Pray for the workers. Pray for the workers. And the disciples and the apostles, they pray. Right after that, Jesus sends them out. Why? Because they was always called to be the workers. They were always called to be the miracles. It was them. And Jesus is trying to open up their mind like, dude, You're the solution to the world's problem. It's not another nonprofit. It's not another GoFundMe thing. It's never that. It was the spiritual condition of the world. And the only one who had the answers were those who were set apart to do the work of God, to go liberate and free a lost and dying world. Are you with me? And that's you guys. You are the miracle. But it's not enough for me to just convince you here from the pulpit to tell you that. It's not enough for your leader, your Bible talk leader, to convince you in your talk times on a weekly basis. It's not enough to tell you that. You have to know it for yourself. That's why in the scriptures in Hebrews 5:4 it says, no one takes his honor on himself, but he receives it when he's called by God, just as Aaron was. Do you believe you're called by God this morning? It's not just a feeling, it's a knowing. It's deep convictions of who God said you is. Not what the world tells you who you are. Not your identity rooted what the world tells you to be. But your identity found in the scriptures, and that only comes from you spending time with God and believing in who God calls you to be. Amen? You know, there's a popular quote by Marianne Williamson that says, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that frightens us the most. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your plan small does not serve the world. There's nothing enlightened about shrieking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We're all meant to shine as children do. We are born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us in Southland. That is who we are. Are you with me? But I want to challenge us. Know that you're called by God. Know that you're called by God. Know that you're called by God. And know that you are a miracle. Here's a practical. Just find your identity from the scriptures and who God calls you to be. And oftentimes we could be there, but then we could forget. We could just go through life and we just forget, right? I want to challenge you to take captive that thought, make it obedient to the Bible, and go back to who God calls you to be. Are you with me, church? Here's the thing. Once you know that you're a miracle, now you actually get to live like you're a miracle, which brings me to my second point. Live like you are a miracle. Let's go back to our text in Nehemiah chapter 2. Live like you're a miracle. I think that's something Nehemiah understood. He knew that he was called by God. He knew that he was sent by God. And because of those deep convictions, now he can actually live that out freely in his walk with God. Nehemiah chapter 2, we pick it up here in verse 18, in the second half of it. It says, they replied, let us start rebuilding. So they began this good work. But when Sanballat, the Horonite, Tobiah, the Ammonite, official in Geshem, the Arab, heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed us. What is this you are doing, they asked. Are you rebelling against the king? I answered them by saying, the God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding, but as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or historic right to it. Chapter 3, verse 1. It says, Eliashib, the high priest and his fellow priests, went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. They dedicated it and set its doors in place, building as far as the Tower of the Hundred, which they dedicated, and as far as the Tower of Hananel, the man of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zachar, son of Imri, built next to him. Live like you're the miracle. You see, here we see Nehemiah and the man beginning to rebuild the walls all over again. Remember, before this, it was broken down. And now they know that they're called by God. Now they know that they're their solution. And then now they're actually putting their money where their mouth is. They're not just talking the talk. Oh, yeah. They're walking the walk. And so they begin to rebuild. And it's really cool how you see here in verse 2 in chapter 3, it says they were building next to one another. So, you know, one guy is building this section of the wall. It's like, awesome. And then the other side is building this section of the wall. And hey, you got that in. And I got this in. And you got it? Yes, I got it. And it's just this togetherness, building up the walls of Jerusalem. And the crazy part, even in the midst of opposition, we pick it up here in verse 19. Remember there in chapter 2. And it's interesting that the moment when these guys start to do something good, evil is right there. You ever catch that? Like, the moment we're like, you know what? I'm going to get my life together. I'm gonna get my marriage together. I'm gonna do better in parenting. I'm going to do better just for myself and be disciplined and have self-control and yada and yada and yada. But right there, evil is just right there crouching at the door. And we see this in Nehemiah's time, that the moment they decide to build, like, you know what? I want to build up the kingdom. Sanballat and the guys that were just kind of opposing, they were like the satanic characters here. And it happened to be the verse right after. It doesn't even give it like a whole chapter before these guys come into play. It's like the verse right after. And so we can't be surprised as we're trying to do good in our lives and be so faked out that Satan doesn't want to take you out. The moment we decide to do something good, and even like for some of us to come back to church and be more freaking and consistent about that, even in itself, don't be faked out when Satan is trying to get you to compromise and tempt you to say, hey, just sleep a little bit longer. You don't have to go to church. You don't have to pray to God. You don't have to confess your sin. You know what I mean? Like, it's just these temptations that's just in your ear. And you got to be like Nehemiah here. It's like, hey, the God of heaven will give us success. He's just the minister arguments in his mind. It's like, hey, God is with me, dude. Back up. You follow me? And I think that has to be our same mindset. That's some good water right there. But just think about the amount of trust they had to have for each other. The amount of unity they had to have for each other and work together here to build up their different parts of the wall. How did this look a little bit more? Look at verse 12. We'll pick it up here in the same chapter, Nehemiah chapter 3, verse 12. How did this look? Let's look at it together. In verse 12, it says, Shalom, son of Heliash, ruler of the half district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section with the help of his daughters. Come on, sisters. In verse 13, it says, the valley gate was repaired by Hanan in the residence of Zonoiah. They rebuilt it and put its doors with its bolts and bars in place. They also repaired 1,000 cubits of the wall as far as the dung gate. Verse 14, the dung gate was repaired by Micaiah, son of Rechab's, ruler of the district of Beth Hekarim. He rebuilt it and put its doors with their bolts and bars in place. The fountain gate was repaired by Shalon, son of Kohazah, ruler of the district of Mizpah. He rebuilt the roof and it over and put in his doors and bolts and bars in place. He also repaired the wall of the pool of Siloam by the king's garden as far as the steps going down from the city of David. Beyond him, Nehemiah, son of Asbach, ruler of the half-district of Bezar, made repairs up to the point opposite the tombs of David, as far as the artificial pool in the house of the heroes. What do we see here? We see men and women working together, building up the walls of Jerusalem. What else do we see? It's interesting that when the Bible repeats something time in and time out, it shows that it's of importance, right? Throughout at least this passage, you see men who are also rulers of a district. Meaning they had other things going on in their lives. They had other responsibilities. They had other jobs that they could cater to. But yet, they were able to bend their schedules, prioritize God in their life, prioritize building up the kingdom to do the work of God. Everyone was all in. It was a steadfastness there. It was a dog-eat-dog determination to get this job done. Because they understood it. They were building it for men. They were building it for their God. And I love in verse 16, it says, the house of the heroes, that this repairs was going on. And other verses in the Bible says, the house of the mighty men. And it's interesting because some believe that this could have been the place where David's mighty men or David's soldiers during his day and age would have dwelt and resided in Jerusalem. How cool is that? Think about the legacy behind that. Think about all the heroes of faith that came throughout Jerusalem and now they get to rebuild all of that again. And the cool thing is that was the same place where they got the chance to be a part of. It was their lineage. And later, as we know with the story of Nehemiah, he actually completes building the wall in 52 days. And you may think, well, 52 days building a wall around Jerusalem? Woo! In the midst of opposition? Woo! You see what I'm saying? Only a miracle. Only a miracle from God. And we understand that God provides the miracles. But he wants his people to be a part of it. God provides the miracle and carries out the miracles ultimately. We all know that. However, he uses men and women to be a part of it. And we see that all throughout the Bible. I mean, the time of Moses, God worked through him to lead the people out of Egypt. He split the Red Sea. It wasn't Moses that split the Red Sea. It was God who did the miracles. We see this through the time of Joshua. Well, they're going around the walls of Jericho 7 times. Then all of a sudden, the walls collapse. It was a miracle from God, but God worked through Joshua. We see this during the time of Jesus and his apostles. Turn the world upside down, not just through their own inclination or strength, right? But the strength and the acts of the Holy Spirit. Time in and time out, God provided miracles and called men and women to be a part of it. And I think that's something we just got to remember here in Southland. Like, man, Southland is the house of heroes. Southland has many heroes in the faith. It's so many people all throughout the years have been in these seats or been in this ministry that went out and did incredible things for God. I mean, think about it. The lineage is so rich. Kip and Corey led the Cross and Switchblades ministry back in the 90s here in this area, geographically, as we call it today, Southland, right? They did it in the 90s. I mean, Paul and Kim Hammond were baptized and appointed here in a former fellowship and appointed again in a new fellowship here. I mean, the Blackwells were here, and a lot of you guys were baptized underneath their leadership, and now they went out to do incredible things for God. Nick and Denise Borderi, the Bouyes, one of the Bouyes senior are coming back here to Southland as well. I mean, the Hardens was here, the Cosies was here. The list goes on and on and on. R.D. Baker was here, the Federalicas were here, the Turners, the Joneses, the Petersons, the Georges, and so forth. I mean, wow. A house of heroes. Southland comes from a full lineage of heroes in the faith who went out and did incredible things for God. How amazing is that? Like, we could forget that after. We need to tap in and just embrace that for a second, amen? And I think for us today, right now, we have to understand as a region, over the years, we sacrificed a lot. I mean, that's why a lot of these men and women were risen up because of you guys' faith. And they were strengthened because of that, and they went out to go do incredible things for God because of you guys' sacrificial hearts. But I think sometimes Satan will love to creep in there in your minds oftentimes, and we could begin to feel like, well, that's all great that all the mighty men and women went out. That's it. They went out. All the mighty men and women, they're gone now. And God, from his scriptures, could be like, don't be so foolish. Don't sell yourself short. The great, mighty men and women are in this room. The great, mighty men and women are in this room right now, right? Because you got to understand, the great and mighty men are you. The interesting part that we forget about this passage and this whole story of Nehemiah is that Nehemiah, he went back to his countrymen. But what did he go back to? He went back to the people that were already there. You see what I'm saying? Oftentimes in Southland, we'd be like, okay, we sent out a lot of people. That's true. It's true. But what about the people in the infrastructure that's still here? That's the people that Nehemiah rallied to believe again. Those were the people that faith just got fused and fanned into flame again, where they start to believe that God can work through them. And God did, and he built up the wall of Christianity, amen? That's who we are to be this morning. Not just those who's like, okay, well, the mighty men are in Apia, Samoa. The mighty man is in Iowa City. The mighty man is in Chicago. Right. No, the mighty men and women are you guys. Yeah. You know, that's why it says in Romans 12, it says to offer yourself as a living sacrifice. Southland has been offering themselves year after year after year after year. It doesn't stop. And it's not going to stop until Jesus comes back. But the encouraging thing, the incredible thing is you guys are the miracle. And the only thing God was waiting for is just one guy that was willing to answer that call. And I got to ask you, is that you? One guy, one girl, willing to answer the call, to know that they're called by God, to know that they are the miracle, and then rally those around them in this room to be the miracle, to live out being a miracle. I think that's why it says in Romans 10, verses 14 to 15, it says, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Family, we are those who bring good news. Not just with beautiful feet. Amen. But we are those who have the gospel, the truth, the cosmos in our hand to do something about it. That has the truth that can liberate a lost and dying world. Because we are the miracle here in Southland. Are you with me? Yeah. And you got to ask yourself, if not you, then who? If Moses Cooley don't do it, then who? If James doesn't do it, then who? If Jonathan doesn't do it, then who? You are the miracle. Live like you are the miracle. Amen? We got to understand it's not enough for us to just come to church and fill up a seat. We have to build up the church of God. And the way we build it up is just staying close to God, yes. Praying to God, yes. But also doing the work of God, sharing our faith, getting people to Bible study so they too can have salvation like you and I have, as we're going to see later with Monique. You know, just like Nehemiah, pray like it depends on God, but work like it depends on you. You know, as I conclude, I believe God wants to do great things here in Southland. Because God has already done great things in Southland because of you guys' faith. But he wants to do more. My encouragement to the church is to not just watch and look for the miracles this year or next year, but be the miracles. I would like to close out with the very words of Yoda from Star Wars. You know, I love this scene in one of the Star Wars movies. Yoda, very wise. And he was trying to get Luke Skywalker to really believe in himself, to understand that he has the force that's with him. And there was this scene where Luke Skywalker was by his faith, was supposed to get this ship out of the water. And he was just so like, I can't do it, man. I can't. And Yoda does it and shows him how it's really done, right? And he says something really that's really profound, I believe, that we need to hear just as well. And Luke Skywalker, he was just blown away. And Yoda tells him, he says, do or do not, there is no try. And we got to understand that for those here in this room, that in our generation, there's no trying. There's only doing. And the way you do it is by being a miracle. Being a miracle by knowing that you're the miracle. That you're set apart and you're called by God to do incredible things that God can work through you. And being a miracle by living like you're a miracle, by doing something about it, not just building up the walls here in Southland, but literally building up the kingdom of God in the walls of Christianity all around the world, if you're with me. Southland, thank you so much for loving me. Thank you so much for loving my wife. Thank you so much for loving my daughter. I love you guys so much. Go and be the miracles, and to God be all the glory.